Azure provides connectivity through multiple resource types. We have public IP addresses, load balancers, app gateways, the Azure Firewall, and our secure network address translation. Network address translation is a method of remapping one IP space into another during transit across a routing device. Incidentally, this is what saved the world from running out of IP addresses on the internet a long time ago, because now we can take an entire company worth of private IP addresses and translate them into one public IP address that actually goes out on the internet. Azure has had secure network address translation since the beginning, but now we're putting it into your hands. So join us as we dig into the new Azure NAT Gateway. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. To understand how the new NAT Gateway fits into Azure, we need to understand something about NAT in the first place. Let me give you an analogy. Let's say that you are a client and you call into an office building. You call the main number of that office because that's the only one that you know. And when you do, you talk to the receptionist and you tell them who you are looking for. The receptionist will then do a lookup, find the person and their extension, and then they will connect your call to them. This is the same way that NAT works. When we have a company, we have a series of private IP addresses and we have a public IP address. So we need to get from our private IPs on the inside to the internet, so we have to go out using our NAT. Let me show you what I mean. We have some VMs, and you can see one of them is labeled NAT VM1, and the other one is NAT VM no public IP. And you can see there's one public IP address in this resource group, and that is connected to this first VM. So opening this guy up, we can see that we have a public IP address of 13.92.168.175, and that has a private IP of 10.0.0.4. Looking at the other VM, we can see that there is no public IP, but we do have an IP address of 10.0.0.5. So here we are in the VM that has that public IP address attached. So if I had something that would respond to that IP address, say a web server, you could go to 13.92.168.175 and you could hit my web server, and that's how I'm RDP'd into this VM right now. Now, if I pull up that other VM that we were looking at, that was the one with the private IP address of 10.0.0.5, and you can see the name here is NAT VM no public IP. Even though it has no public IP address, you can see on the right, we do have a public IP address, and this comes from Azure's secure network address translation, even though I don't have a public IP. Now, the reason why is because you need a way to get out to the internet, so we give you a network address translated IP address. So the NAT Gateway's purpose is to simplify outbound traffic. And to dig in a little bit more on this, let's go to the Azure Docs. So from the main page of the Azure Docs, we'll scroll down and in our table of contents, we'll go to networking. And the NAT Gateway is a function of the Azure Virtual Network. So we'll click on that feature. And then over here on the left in the table of contents, we'll go to concepts, connectivity, and then we'll open NAT and start with our overview. So the NAT Gateway itself is going to be connected to our subnet, and it's going to replace Azure's default secure network address translation. That gateway then will be attached to a public IP address or public IP prefix. So when someone sees your IP address from the destination side, they will see your NATed IP, not your own IP address. Now, this helps to simplify connectivity scenarios, because if you're using something like a web service or you have a standard call that you need to make for an application, you can now use the NAT Gateway and someone on the other end can whitelist your IP and know that it's not going to change. So over on the right side here, we'll click on this link for coexistence of inbound and outbound. So at the bottom of our graphic, we have our two different flow directions, and our solid line shows the outbound request, and the dotted line are the replies that come back from that request. And over on the left, we have subnet A, and that's tied to a load balancer in Azure, and that load balancer has a backend pool, and we have two VMs in that pool. So we've got a few different connectivity options here. because the two VMs are in the load balancer pool, they are effectively behind that load balancer, which is in itself behind the public IP at the top. And you can see that traffic flow is allowed to come in on that public IP address, much in the same way that I was able to RDP into that VM earlier. Over on the right side, we have subnet B, and that's where we have no public IP attached to our VM or our VM scale set. We're using the NAT gateway. And so you can see our traffic flow is the opposite. Outbound connectivity is where the requests start, and then the inbound replies all go through the NAT gateway. So I have no public IPs directly attached. So if when someone looks at their logs, say on a web server or on some kind of application request, they're going to see that my same public IP does not change, so they can whitelist my IP and allow me to use that application service. So the other part of our docs that we're going to need is under the how-to guides. Under there, we'll go to connectivity, we'll open up NAT, and then we'll do create and validate NAT gateway in the portal. So this is going to have the step-by-step we're going to use to set up an environment and then go through some testing. So you can see over here on the right, we're going to create a virtual network in Azure, set up a source VM, then create our NAT gateway, and then we're going to have to create a destination network and a destination VM, and we'll set that up as a web server for us to do some testing with. So in the Azure portal, we'll click the plus to create a new resource, and we'll type in NAT gateway. And then we'll click our create button. So I've already built all of the other resources, and we'll be putting our NAT gateway into our NAT resource group, and we'll call it the My NAT Gateway, and we'll be building this in East US 2. And just a quick note on availability zones, we cannot span zones at this point in the preview. That may change over time when we get to general availability. We'll have to wait and see for that. And this also brings up a good point. A NAT gateway cannot span multiple virtual networks in Azure as well. So keep that in mind as you're doing your deployments. So I'll just leave availability zone set to none for now. Then we have our idle timeout, and this can be anywhere from 4 to 120 minutes. And after that point, we'll remove those idle flows. And if anyone attempts to reuse one of those flows, then we'll send a TCP reset for that. So we'll click next. And now we need to add a public IP address, and this can come in two flavors, a standard public IP address or a public IP prefix. And we have done a video previously on public IP prefixes, which I'll link to in the top right. You can go check that out. And we can have up to 16 public IPs associated with a single NAT gateway. Now, we do not have to add a public IP at this time, but we won't be able to use our gateway without one, so we might as well do it now. So I'll click to add a new public IP address, and we'll just call it my public IP source. And you can see that the values here for the SKU and assignment are hard-coded. This must be a standard public IP address, and it must be set to static. So if you're doing this by code, keep that in mind. We'll hit OK and hit next. And if you like, you can create a brand new virtual network from here and just fill out all of the required information. But I've already created one. So I'll hit the drop down and select my source virtual network. And then I have to select my subnet, and that'll complete the association there. We'll hit next. Now we'll add our tags. And we'll use a cost center so we know who's paying for these resources. It's part of the IT department, and our application is NAT Gateway. And we'll hit next, and then we can review everything that we've set up here, and we'll hit create. All right, now that everything is built, let's check it all out. We'll scroll down to the bottom here, and we've got our source and destination networks. So we'll start in the source, and in the subnets over on the left, then we'll open up our subnet source. And we see that we have successfully attached our NAT gateway to this subnet. Looking at the destination virtual network, however, when we go to our subnets, there is no NAT gateway attached here. Because remember, this is an outbound service, so the destination side is not going to have the NAT gateway. It's going to be receiving that IP from the NAT gateway. The virtual machines in this case are pretty unremarkable. So if we go to our source VM, we have a public IP address of 40.70.159.53, and we have a private IP of 192.168.0.4. Now, if we go back to the other virtual machine, we'll see something interesting. So we've got a public IP address of 52.167.250.71, and we also have a private IP of 192.168.0.4. So here's another use case for the NAT gateway. Normally in Azure, you cannot have two different virtual networks with the same IP space connected and talking to each other. The NAT gateway allows us to have the same private IPs, but be able to communicate from one VM to another. This may be useful if you're promoting code, say from your dev environment into your prod environment, or you have VMs that need to connect into a shared services network and they're sharing the same IP space and you can't have them peered. Or like the case we're going to show here of a web server. So back in our resource group, we'll scroll up a little bit and let's take a look at the NAT gateway itself. So starting at the top, we've got some of our details around our NAT gateway. We can see which virtual network it is attached to, how many subnets in that network it is attached to, and if we are using a public IP address or a public IP prefix, and how many. We can have up to 16 IP addresses connected to one NAT gateway in this public preview, and that may change over time. And if you have a use case that uses more than the 16 public IPs, please give me some comments down below because we'd love to get some more information from you. Now, in the center here, we have configuring an outbound IP address and configuring subnets, which we can also go to the links on the left here. So I'll click on our public IPs and we can see there is our NAT public IP address. Now this is unique from either of the IPs that are attached to our VMs. And if you wanted to change addresses, we can do that as well just by clicking our change button. And then in this flyout, we can select a different public IP that we want to use. Just be aware that you cannot use a public IP that's already associated with something else. Now, additionally, we can add public IP prefixes. Now, I don't have any public IP prefixes here at the moment, but we can create one rather quickly just by clicking on Create New, giving it a name. And then we select the size of the prefix block that we want to use. And just be aware that when you allocate a block of any size, you'll be paying for that number of IP addresses. So I'll just select a /31 here and click OK. And we'll click OK to close that. Then we have to hit the save button to apply those changes. And that'll just take a moment. While that's going on the left, we'll go to our configuration. And this is where we can set that idle timeout in case we need to change that. And again, the limit here is from 4 minutes to 120 minutes. And the rest of the items over here in the blade are standard for Azure. Your properties will have your Azure resource ID and generic information. You can secure your NAT gateway with a lock, and that can be a read-only lock or a delete lock. And you can also export your template here for your NAT gateway, and that'll have your settings and configurations, public IP address assignments, so that you can reuse this in another deployment. And under the monitoring section, we have our metrics, and there are a few metrics to choose from here. We have our byte count, dropped packets, total number of packets, SNAT connection, and total SNAT count. And this is something that we'll see some improvements in as the service continues to develop. So if you're interested in some more data points around your NAT gateway, please give me some comments below and I'll pass them along to our product group. Then of course, like anything else in metrics, you can create alerts from here or pin these items to your dashboard so you can keep an eye on them. So with that, let's do some testing. So we're starting off in our destination VM. And if I open my web browser and go to my localhost web page, we're running our web server that we set up with our custom script extension. And at the bottom, it says, welcome to my web server, my VM destination, Azure Academy Rocks. And in IIS, we'll open up our logging settings and then I'll click select fields here. And I have modified this just to keep the amount of text in the logs to a minimum. But we have our date and time, which IP address our client is coming from, that would be our source, our server IP, which is our destination, and the port number that is used. Now with that in mind, here is our log. And so this reads from left to right, which is our date, then time, the server IP address, which has got a colon, colon, 1. Then we have port 80, because that's the web port. And then we have ::1 again, because I issued the command to go to the website from this system. Now, what if I do this from my source VM in Azure? And this is the one that is behind our NAT gateway. We browse over to our destination VM and we see the same web page. Welcome to my web server, Azure Academy Rocks. If you did not have a NAT gateway, what you would expect is that we'd have this 40.70 IP address that would show up in our logs. Let's find out. But you see in our logs that we have the NAT gateway's address here instead, not the 40.70 address. So the outbound traffic from our source VM is hitting our destination through the NAT gateway itself. We can consider this a known good IP address, and now we can whitelist it. But as I showed earlier, Azure VMs don't need a public IP in order to get to the internet. So what would happen if we had another VM behind that NAT gateway that also tried to hit this destination? And we'll open up our web browser and go right back to our destination. And there we go. Before we check the logs on our destination server, we're going to open another tab and go to whatismyip.com. And we can see that our public IP is now showing as 52.167.64.57, which is the outbound address of our NAT gateway. So now let's go back and look at our logs. So the line that I have highlighted was the log that we looked at last time, and our most recent log is from the same IP. Now we can further expand the reach of our singular NAT gateway under subnets and click on manage subnets. Then we just add a new subnet at the top. We'll call it new subnet, and we've got an IP space of 192.168.1.0/24, and we'll attach the NAT gateway directly to that. And if we go back to our NAT gateway, we can see now we've got two subnets here. And back up in the overview, we're covering two subnets here as well. And inside that new subnet we've just created, I've stood up yet another VM, and we'll RDP into that VM. And we'll open our web browser and go right back to our destination VM, which of course we can hit no problem. And according to whatismyip.com, we've got that same IP of 52.167.64.57. And according to the latest log here, we see that's the IP that we come across using our NAT gateway once again. So I hope that you've enjoyed looking at the new Azure NAT gateway that helps you to simplify your outbound connectivity, span multiple subnets across a single virtual network, and be fully managed and highly resilient thanks to multiple public IPs. If you thought that this video was good, let us know that you liked it by clicking that thumbs up icon. And while you're down there, why don't you click on the subscribe button and join us here at the Azure Academy community, where we're all just trying to learn more about Azure if you haven't done that already. And if you'd like to receive an email notifying you when our new videos come out, which is about once a week, you can click on the notification bell there as well. And over here on the right, you can click on our latest video or watch one that we've selected just for you over on the bottom. Let us know what questions you have down in the comments field or any feedback you'd like to share with us so we can keep on improving the Azure Academy for you. Thanks very much for joining us today, and we'll see you in the next video. Happy learning.